glad to have you today at our Bible study in 1 Peter. Hope that changes everything. And today we're in chapter 4, verses 7 through the end of the chapter. And this, we've called this hope that flips suffering. We're going to suffer, but we have this incredible hope. We found out in chapter 1, it's when we were told that we have a living hope because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And as I keep reminding you, we are the only faith, the only religious system that has a living Savior. I think we often take that for granted. No one else has that. That's why we have the hope that's living. He's living. He can fulfill every promise He ever made to us. We have a living hope. And then we also found in chapter 1 that we have this amazing inheritance that's waiting for each one of us, and it will be amazing beyond description. I think human mind cannot even imagine right now what God has prepared for those who love Him. It's going to be absolutely phenomenal. And so Peter says, "In this you greatly rejoice. You have much to be thankful for, much to rejoice about, even though for a short time you may have to suffer grief in all kinds of trials." He said, "These have come so that your faith, which is more precious than gold that perishes, even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed." So we have this amazing hope that will help take us through suffering. And when we go through suffering, he told us, it will strengthen our faith. After we go through suffering, we're different women than we were before we went through that suffering. And it also proves our faith genuine. It proves that we totally believe Him. We hold on to Him. And then he concludes that section we just talked about in chapter 1 with, even though you haven't seen Him, you love Him. And even though you don't see Him now, you believe in Him, and you are filled with inexpressible and glorious joy. The amazing thing about having a living hope is that we can rejoice in suffering. And that's how Peter begins his book. We're getting toward the end of the book in chapter 4, this section that we're going through today. And he kind of goes over some of that theme with us again to remind us about the joy in suffering and why we can enjoy in suffering. But before he does, as we get into verse 7, he says, you notice, the end of all things is near. Now, this was written 2,000 years ago, and he said the end of all things is near. If it was near then, it's even nearer 2,000 years later. But you have to understand that spiritually, the Bible is kind of divided. Human history is kind of divided into two main times. The time, Old Testament times, looking forward to the coming of the Savior. Everything that was written in the Old Testament was looking forward. The prophets talked about the Savior to come. And then the New Testament, of course, Jesus comes. And then the New Testament looks forward to the second coming of Jesus. The Old Testament looked forward to His first coming. The New Testament looks forward to the rapture and His second coming. So when he says the end of all things is near, he's saying we are in the final days of looking forward to Jesus coming for us. And Hebrews 1 says that in the past God spoke to the forefathers through the prophets, but in these last days He's spoken to us by His Son. So everything since Jesus is part of the last days, because as we look forward to Jesus, His coming is imminent. And we must be ready for Him, because we don't know when He's going to come. But we know when Jesus ascended into heaven, that the angel said to the disciples, "Why are you looking up into heaven? This same Jesus who's taken up from you into heaven will come again in the same way you've seen Him go." We know for sure He's coming. We just don't know when. We know we're in the final period of human history, and we are to be ready for Him to come at any moment, any time from his ascension until he comes again. That is all the final days. So we are in the final days. Now we know there are end times that come after that, and the scriptures tell us a lot about that as well. So he says, you know you're in the final days. And so he says, be clear-minded and self-controlled so you can pray. He tells us in this first paragraph we're studying today about what the Church of Jesus Christ can do to be ready to suffer and to suffer well. Because we are in the last times, and we know that suffering will increase in these last times because of faith in Jesus Christ, and not only faith. We suffer not only for our faith, but we also suffer because we're Christians, because God has a purpose in suffering. He wants to make us more like Jesus Christ, and he does that through suffering. I always call it the spoiled child syndrome. If I never, ever had any suffering in my life, I would be the most spoiled Christian you could ever imagine, and you would not want to be around me. I would be just like that spoiled kid that you can't stand to spend the day with. That God wants to file off those rough spots on us, and he knows the only way we will respond is through suffering, when we have to look to him. And as we go through those, our faith, we are refined and made more like Jesus. And so that's his purpose in this time of suffering. And he wants us as a church to be prepared for suffering. And he tells us here different ways we can be prepared. First, he says we have to be self-controlled and clear-minded so we can pray. I think we all understand what that means. We have to be focused and disciplined, understanding what's going on all around us and the need to pray, and then we have to be able to be disciplined to do it, and we have to be focused in order to stay on task. You know what I mean. We've all prayed, and then pretty soon we notice we were thinking about we need to go get a load of clothes out of the dryer. I got to do this. Something's happening this afternoon. I got to go to the grocery store and pick something up. It's so easy to lose our focus in prayer. So he says we need to be clear-minded, understand our need for prayer, and we need to be self-controlled. Now, Peter was probably especially concerned about this because you remember this malady has affected Christians ever since we were praying, because we remember in Gethsemane when Jesus left his disciples and he asked them to watch and pray. And what did they do? Fell asleep, just like we do when we're praying. Easy to fall asleep. And Peter knew the importance of being self-controlled and focused in his prayers, because what happened after he fell asleep? As Jesus was taken from Gethsemane across the Kidron Valley by the soldiers, every single disciple left him. All 12 of them deserted him and left Jesus alone. And then as Peter was watching from afar off in the courtyard, he denied Jesus 3 times. So Peter understands the importance of being focused and self-controlled and staying on task in prayer. It's just as hard for us today as it was for him. So when we know we need to pray, it's always a high priority for us, but especially when we're going through persecution, we need to make sure that we are prayers, that the Church of Jesus Christ is a praying church. So I have just a few suggestions to help us, because I struggle with this just like you struggle with this, and like every Christian probably struggles with this. The old nature, it's a contrary to the old nature, and Satan doesn't want us to spend time in prayer because he knows that the prayers of the righteous are powerful and effective. So what I would suggest is that we all set a regular time for prayer. Now, I know that this is hard at times when our schedules are changed. For example, if we have company, overnight company, if the grandkids are staying with us, or some special event comes up in our lives, I find those the hardest times because my schedule is so different. But set a time that works for you. And I think this is a very individual thing. Some people say you have to pray in the morning, some people have to pray at night. I think whatever works for you so you can do it then. But I also have one suggestion that everybody who's ever heard me speak before knows about. When I always tell people, women, before you ever get out of bed in the morning, before your feet hit the floor, pray for your family. Pray for your husband, for your children and in-laws and all of your grandchildren. And the reason I say this is that we all know how things can happen in our day. Things can come up unexpectedly that we weren't expecting, and maybe we don't have time to set a time, that prayer time that we had scheduled. At least we have brought those who are nearest and dearest to us, our families, before the throne of grace and committed them to God for that day, for His protection, for His leadership in their life, that they will love Him with all their heart and soul and strength and mind, that they will glorify Him in their life. All of that, I make that a habit before I ever get out of bed, so that those people will always be prayed for. I think that's one of the main responsibilities of mothers and grandmothers especially, but all women, to pray for their families, extended families. Then the next thing I suggest is that you have some kind of prayer list. Now, I had some prayer cards to bring to you to show you what works for me, but I think if we don't have definite things written before us to pray about that need our devoted and continual prayer, we forget about some of them. People we love that we said we'd pray for and we didn't write it down and we forget. We pray them for them when we think about it, but if it's something that we want to continually pray for, write it down. And when you go to your prayer time, have that list with you. Now, the way that I have found that works for me, and I tell you I have to do this because if I don't do this, I don't pray for everything I need to pray for. So I have a set of cards, and in these cards, I have 8 cards. One of them is a colored, they're just 3x5 cards. One of them is a colored card, and the rest of them are white. The colored card is for special needs that I change every week. If somebody wants me to pray for them especially, I put them on that card so that every day that week. For example, there's someone in this room today that we are praying for. And so she is on my pink card to remember to pray for her each day this week. And then the other 7 cards are cards for every day of the week. And so on Monday, I have certain requests that I pray for. I try to put the missionaries that we support as a church and as the ones that we support as a family, not all on one day, but spread them out through the week so that over the course of the week, I have prayed for them. I add one of my children, although I prayed for my children when I get up, I pray for put one family, I have 4 children, so one family especially is on the focus of each day's prayer. Then I pray for my church. I pray we have ministries of the church. And these are all divided up. And I pray for the country. And I pray for the persecuted church. And that is on my Sunday card. That's why you often hear me pray for the persecuted church at church, because that's something I do every Sunday. So whether you do it in a notebook or whether you use these cards like I do, make sure you have a plan, because if we don't have a plan, we often don't stick to it, and it's easy to miss people that we especially need to pray for. Then, another thing, if you have a special prayer time at home, and you find that it's easy to lose focus, as I do, pray out loud. You'll be amazed how that will keep you focused in prayer when you're praying out loud. When you're thinking, praying mentally and spiritually, that's when you think about these other things. But when your voice is in concert with your mind, it's easier to stay on topic, and you find you won't get nearly as distracted. One thing I found that in praying, that sometimes after I'll pray for someone, let's say I'm praying for Jan, and then I'll think, I need to write her a note. And then I'll think, oh dear, I got distracted. And then I think, no, that's God prompting me to do something in answer to prayer. So be alert for God's answers to you as you're praying. And then take care of those things. Maybe just jot it down, and when you're finished, go do it. And then also, it's easy for us to pray, especially for physical needs. And you know, in our demographic, we have lots of physical needs. We have always, always, always have friends, neighbors, church members who need prayer for physical needs. That's an easy thing to remember. Don't forget to pray for spiritual needs as well, especially in these days we're in. In days when persecution could be around the corner, because we know we're in the final days. Scripture tells us we are. So don't forget, don't neglect to pray for the spiritual needs of your family, your friends, your neighborhood, your church, and your country. Then also, I always pray for protection from the evil one, because we all know that the evil one wants to attack every single one of us. He's constantly roaming about, seeking whom he may devour. So pray for protection, for physical protection as well, and protection from evil, that we will recognize evil and sin and get rid of it. And of course, we pray for forgiveness for sin as well. Another thing you can do to help you in your prayer life is join the CCSB prayer team. Sandy is one of our prayer leaders, and she's here with us today. I don't understand why every single woman in our church isn't a member of our prayer team. The prayer team every month gives us, and it's coming up this Friday, Dorothy Nelson will send to us a list of all of those who need prayer in our church family, and those who are committed to the prayer team will pray through each one of those. We usually meet here in the parish house. However, during COVID, we've had to pray individually at home since we couldn't be together. I hope soon we'll be able to come back together. But we are each praying. We try to do it that very same day, at the same time if we can, but to pray for each of those requests. And that will keep you informed of all of the physical needs of our church family, and also spiritual needs as well. And also then, a lot of times we will receive these request throughout the month on the internet, and we're asked to pray for them whenever we receive them. As soon as you read that prayer request, pray. And so we have when you have a need, it's a wonderful thing, because a lot of women are praying, men too, are praying for that need for you. So I think everyone should join the prayer team. You can see Sandy. You can see Dorothy Nelson or Margaret Falkowski if you would like to join that. We would love to have you join. Then the last thing I'll mention is pray for revival. Pray for revival personally. And when we pray for revival, we pray that God will the Holy Spirit will convict us of sin, that we will get rid of all sin in our lives, so that our lives will be clean vessels for Him to use, because we need the influence of godly women, and we need the prayer power that godly men and women can bring to the Church of Jesus Christ and to our communities and to our country, to our world at this time. So pray that God will bring revival. 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways and seek my face, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Something we should all be praying. So he says, make sure that you are self-controlled, clear-minded, focused, so you can pray. The Church of God should be praying every day. We should be a powerful force in prayer because the prayers of the righteous are powerful. They're effective. And that's why Satan hates them. Don't let him get the best of you in prayer. First thing for a church that's going to go through persecution, pray. Be a praying church. And then you'll see that the next thing it tells us to do is, above all, love each other deeply. Why? Because love covers over a multitude of sins. So, I am to love each one of you, love everyone in our church family. I am to love unselfishly and deeply. Why? Because we all are sinners. We all have faults. We all have quirks. We all can be annoying at times. And so, if I don't have a deep love for you, when you are annoying, I get upset with you. And when I am annoying, you get upset with me. And so the Church of Jesus Christ is to function as a body. We're not to be angry at each other all the time. And also, when I'm annoyed with you, I often gossip about you to other women and let them know that I am upset with you because of what you did. Is that a part of the Church of Jesus Christ? No, 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 no. Did you hear that? We are not to be a gossiping church. We are to be a loving church. And when we love each other, it helps us overlook all of those things about other people that bother us, that annoy us, that make us angry. So we are to love deeply, as he already told us, love deeply from the heart, so that we can overlook those things that bother us, annoy us. Now, we know from other scriptures that if there is a deep sin, something like that, then we are to go to the person and discuss it with them. But we all just have these crazy quirks that get on other people's nerves, and we can't let that divide us as a Church of Jesus Christ. So if we're going to face persecution, we need to be a praying church, we need to be a loving church. And the next thing he says, we should be a hospitable church. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Now, this was especially important in Peter's day when this was written, because, as you know, from our study of Acts, in Acts chapter 7, when Stephen was persecuted, and he was persecuted and stoned and died, and then the persecution from that spread out to the church at Jerusalem, and so they started leaving Jerusalem to flee the persecution. And they started going to the areas in Antioch, Cyprus, Phoenicia, the very areas that Peter is now writing. Those were the areas that these people were fleeing the persecution in Jerusalem. And so he's writing to those people. Now, why was it important to offer hospitality without grumbling? Because there might be a whole family coming who are fleeing Jerusalem and trying to get to Antioch, but they didn't have money to afford food and lodging everywhere along the way. And so Christians would open up their homes and let these strangers, Christians, into their homes and keep them so that they could keep on going on their journey. We know inns were in short supply. How do we know that? There was no room for them in the inn. So then Christians had to be those inns and offer hospitality to people they didn't know. And they were to do it how? Without grumbling. Now, today, we don't usually have to do that in that same sense, but we still are to be hospitable. That's to be a mark of the Christian church. Now, I grew up in a family, a Christian family, and my mother modeled this for us well, and I'm so thankful that she did. We went to a small church, and so if there was ever a missionary or a visiting family at the church, my mother was the one who invited him to come to our house for Sunday dinner. Now, we had five kids in our family, and we lived in a three-bedroom, two-bath house. And so we each had, you know, a bed, but she would invite people in, and we might have to sleep on the floor. And, you know, I thought everybody did this. I thought if you had company, you just, all the kids would just grab some blankets and make a pallet and sleep on the floor. That's how I grew up. And my mother didn't only do it for a day. She had family members who came to our house for months, and we did this. And I am so glad she did, because one day, there was a pastor who came to our church who preached from Birmingham, Alabama. His name is Dr. Alden Gannett. And so that is how I was introduced to the Gannett family and to my family. And it was because my mother and dad opened up our home and we had him in our home. Then another thing that happened, my dad was in business for himself. And he was from New York State, but we lived in Oklahoma and Tulsa. And he invited his younger brother, who's 12 years younger, to come down to Tulsa to go into business with him and be his business partner. So our uncle lived with us for several months. He was not a believer in Jesus Christ, but our family went to church every Sunday, so he went with us. And one Sunday, it was another Sunday, and Ron's dad was there again. It was a different visit. Ron's dad was there, and my uncle gave his heart to the Lord and was saved. He had been living with our family. He knew there was something different. When he went to church and heard Ron's dad, who was an amazing evangelist, he gave his heart to the Lord. Now, after that, he said he decided he didn't want to go into business with Daddy anymore. He wanted to go into ministry. So my uncle went to train for ministry. He joined Wycliffe Bible Translators. He was in Bogota, Colombia for many years. When he left Colombia, he went back to Dallas and worked in Wycliffe headquarters office. He and my aunt both did. And he just went to be with the Lord this last year. Why? Because of hospitality. Opening up your Christian home to those who don't know the Lord. This past year, a year ago before COVID, we had a little reunion for my family because my mother and my aunt are the last two remaining, and they're both in-laws in my dad's family. And so we said, anybody who can come, come. It was near Christmas time, and I saw cousins I hadn't seen in years from New York and around, and several of them said to me, remember when we stayed at your home all those months? And some of those have become Christians too. So hospitality is to mark a Christian. Now, let's face it, at this stage of life, hospitality isn't always as easy as it used to be. We find it harder. We don't have the energy that we used to have. But there are still ways that we can be hospitable within our church, even maybe without even being in homes. You know, it's so easy for us to meet together, share a meal at one of our HOAs. That is an easy way to spend time and fellowship with each other. Another thing, I think, that while we were at the Gaslight, there's a very easy way for us to be hospitable, and that is they make wonderful pizza at the Gaslight. When you come into church, you can order a pizza. I think you pay for it on your credit card. Then when you walk out of church, they'll have it ready for you. You can invite someone to come home with you and eat in your backyard. You don't even have to go inside. Just have them over to fellowship together. There's no work involved. They can bring their own drinks, or you can serve them water, or iced tea, or whatever. And you can still fellowship together and enjoy hospitality in a very easy way, even at our age if you don't have the energy to cook the big meal. Another thing you can do, of course, is have potlucks, have everybody help if you'd like to have them in your home. And then another thing that we did in our neighborhood, even when COVID first started, what the neighbor on one of our one side of us who comes to our church, and it was very, very hospitable, but it was COVID. We couldn't have meals inside. And so the HOA sells a meal, and you can order it. You can drive by and pick it up. So she would invite us to her home. We were each to buy our own meal at the HOA. We were to pick it up and come to their house. She had a beautiful table set up for us in her backyard, so we didn't have to go inside. And that's how we spent Easter together. We had a wonderful time during COVID, fellowshipping together in the sunshine. And it was a simple way. Now, she went to trouble making her table beautiful and that kind of thing, but she didn't have to prepare the food. We brought all of our own food. We still enjoyed wonderful hospitality and the fellowship, which is so important. Other people, some of whom are here, we've been without a kitchen for 4 months, and still it's going to be another 2 or 3 weeks, I heard this morning. Not the best news to hear just before you're going to teach your Bible study, but some people have been so very hospitable to us during that time. And so once I have a kitchen again, I hope to return the hospitality. We'll see how well I do at that. Anyway, we are to be marked by our hospitality, loving others. And then he ends another thing that should each of us as a church should be involved in. He says in verse 10, each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. Did you notice the first two words of that verse? Each one. Each one, everyone, should use the gift that God has given them to minister God's grace to others. It says he has served others faithfully, administering God's grace in its various forms. He's talking here about spiritual gifts. Each one, every single believer has a gift given to them by the Holy Spirit. And these gifts are to be used within the body of Jesus Christ, the Church of Jesus Christ, and each part does its part, we function together as a body. And it tells us in Ephesians chapter 4 that we are, as we each use our gifts, we prepare each other for works of service. To prepare God's people for works of service. So that means you have a gift and I have a gift. And it also means that we are all to use those gifts. Not one Christian is exempt from this. And 1 Corinthians 12 talks about the spiritual gifts, and it says it's like a body. A body has a lot of parts, but each one of them is important. You don't want to do without your arm, it has a function. You don't want to do without your foot, it has a function. Your eye has a function. Your mouth has a function. Everything has a function. And for your body to operate, you want it all to operate in sync together. And he compares that to what the Church of Jesus Christ is. We are the body of Christ, and we each have a part. Each part is different, but that's what makes it work. If we all only wanted to teach, I wouldn't have anybody to teach. No one would have that. But God has given us each different gifts. He says teaching is one of them, and when you do teach, you are to teach the very words of God. In other words, you teach the scriptures. And in other epistles, and in 2 Peter, he talks about false teachers that come in. It's so important when we are teaching, we are responsible to teach the Word of God. He said not only teaching, but some are serving gifts. And many of the gifts, teaching is also serving. It's, if you're a teacher, that's your way of serving the body of Christ. But there are lots of serving gifts as well. There are some in Romans 12, Ephesians 4, and 1 Corinthians 12. And some of these are He has given some to be evangelists. Now, Ron thinks that this is something that every believer can do because we are all to witness of our faith. So there are some who have special gifts of evangelism. We've all seen that in Billy Graham, the greatest probably evangelist of our time. But everyone can be involved in evangelism. Then, of course, the gifts of pastor, teachers. And pastor is not only the lead pastor of the church, but also the those who shepherd you in your group have that gift of shepherding, which is what a pastor is. They would also have that gift. Teachers, and this teaching can be anyone who teaches. Teaches children, adults, anybody in the church, serving, a gift of serving others. And there are certain people that just have that gift of serving. They love to help. They have the gift of help. And if you ever have a need, they're right there to help you. Giving is a gift. This is another gift like that every single believer can have because we are all to give back to the Lord in gratefulness and thanksgiving for what He's given to us, and we give back to Him. And so we're each to give to our church. Leadership is a church. We have those in our church who lead, those who show mercy in our church, those who visit the sick, help the sick. We have the In Touch team, we have a pastor who visits and shows the gift of mercy to those who have especially physical or spiritual needs. The gift of wisdom, the gift of knowledge, the gift of discernment, understanding what is it of God, what is it not of God. The gift of faith, another gift that we can all have, believing that what God has said, He will do. That would be, of course, someone who especially has the gift of praying for people because they have the faith to believe that God will answer prayer. So you can see that as everybody in the church is using one of their gifts in whatever way it is, and I haven't mentioned all of them, if everybody is using a gift, imagine how the church works together and how much we can accomplish for the cause of Jesus Christ in our community. If each part does its part. So, if you don't know your spiritual gift, you can look and figure out what kinds of things you enjoy doing, what kinds of things you like to do and that bring you great joy as you serve the Lord. For example, Sunday at church, it was Cookie Sunday, and Linda Crum and her team worked together to give us cookies and coffee and water and whatever else. And if you were there, you saw that they did it with joy. You could tell that they were really enjoying serving us. And if you were there, you could also tell that we were really enjoying what they were doing for us. They were using their gift of serving in doing that. So when we all do that, when we all use our gift with joy, we administer God's grace in the church in various forms. So each part does its part. So we are then prepared. God's people are prepared for service. Spiritual gifts, extremely important. There are sites on the internet. I started to write it down. I forgot to. But if you look on one, you can find ways to help you find out what your spiritual gift if you don't know. By this time in life, I hope everybody is aware. So it says, if anyone serves, he should do it with the strength God provides so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To Him be the glory and power forever and ever. So all of our gifts are not for attention to ourselves at all. That's not why they're given. But they are so that God can be praised through Jesus Christ. When we use our gifts for Him, it brings glory to Him. So that is what the church is to be like briefly. Because we are going to go through suffering, we're going to go through persecution, and we need to be prepared. So when we are a praying, loving, hospitable, serving church, that helps prepare us for the suffering that we will go through. And then he addresses his hope in suffering. Dear friends, don't be surprised at the painful trial you're suffering. He's been telling us about it all along, that we are going to suffer. So when a trial comes to you, don't be surprised. You know it's going to come because it has a good purpose, as though something strange were happening to you. But instead of being surprised, what does he tell us to do? Something we rarely do when we're suffering, I think, but rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. Okay, we are to be glad that we can suffer for his name's sake. In doing this, we follow the example of Jesus. In Hebrews chapter 12, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. So Jesus knew he had to go through terrible pain and anguish and suffering at the cross. He had to go through that so that we could be saved and forgiven and receive his gift of salvation. But he knew that after he went through that terrible time of suffering, that there would be a time of incredible joy after that, when he would bring all of these many sons to glory. We would be saved and forgiven. So pain first, joy afterward. And when we suffer, we are to realize that we are suffering because we are following in the footsteps of Jesus. And God wants to use that suffering to make us more like Jesus. So we will all on this earth go through suffering. Now, these people at this time were suffering a great deal for their faith. They were persecuted because they were Christians. That's why they were fleeing, because their lives were in danger. They were killed, like Stephen was. We have, in the U.S., in the last several hundred years, have not had to be persecuted for our faith. But we are approaching the last times, and that time may be coming. And so we need to realize that when we suffer, it is because we are counted worthy to suffer for his name. And we are to rejoice in that. Romans 8 tells us that the suffering this present time, it cannot even be compared to what's coming after the suffering. Like Jesus went through the pain for the glory that came afterwards, what we go through here to make us prepare us for eternity, it cannot even be compared to what we're going to get. There is no ratio that can express today's suffering with the glory that will come. That's why we can rejoice. We are worthy of suffering for his name, and we know that he is preparing us to be like Jesus Christ. So we are to be glad. He said, when you suffer, it's not good to suffer for something being bad. Only if you suffer as a Christian, don't be ashamed, but praise God that you bear his name. Then I just want to quickly explain, for it's time for judgment to begin with the family of God. You may have wondered what that meant when you read it. The judgment, remember, our sins have already been judged. It's not judgment for sin that we will face after death. This is the discipline that we endure now. When we sin, Hebrews chapter 12 tells us that God disciplines those he loves. Why? So we won't sin anymore. So we'll get the sin out of our lives. It's just like you've disciplined your children. God as a loving father disciplines us. And that's the kind of judgment it's talking about here. And then it says, and this may have been hard to understand, if it is hard for the righteous to be saved. Now what that means is, not that it's hard to believe, not that it's hard to be forgiven, not that it's hard to become a Christian, but there's a hard life after that. We sometimes thought when we became a Christian that life would be a bed of roses, but that is not God's plan for the Christian. God's plan is that suffering, the glory, the path to glory goes through suffering to make us more like Jesus Christ. And so it is hard for the righteous We don't have a bed of roses, and we will never have a bed of roses, but we can rejoice in our suffering because we know what God is doing. But the ungodly and the sinners will be judged, and theirs will not be to refine them as ours is, the refining fire that we go through. Theirs will instead be the fires of the wrath of God. We have much to be thankful for. So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. I don't know if you remember, probably don't, probably won't remember this one either, but this was Ron's first sermon of the new year, 2020. And don't be surprised, he called it 2020 Surprises. And were we ever surprised in 2020? Whoever would have expected the 2020 that we went through? It was on no one's radar. And yet it says, don't be surprised, you know trials are going to come. And when they do, commit yourselves to your faithful Creator and continue to do good. He will take us through those trials, and we're to continue serving Him even during and after the trials. Now, as we close, there's I think a woman who is a perfect example of suffering for the Lord Jesus and using it for His honor and glory. You've all heard of her often. Her name is Fanny Crosby, and she was born sighted, but at 6 weeks she got sick. The doctor was out of town, and so there was a doctor, a quack, who posed as a doctor, who came to her house, and he put mustard compresses on her eyes, telling the parents that that would get rid of the infection in her eyes, and instead it blinded her. So she was blind her entire life from 6 weeks on. And then that same year her father died. Her mother was only 21, and so she was raised primarily by her Christian grandmother. Her Christian grandmother must have been an amazing grandmother, and who raised her to love the Lord and to accept her blindness, not as suffering, but as a gift. I want to read you a poem that Fanny wrote when she was 8 years old. Oh, what a happy soul I am, although I cannot see. I am resolved that in this world contented I will be. How many blessings I enjoy that other people don't. To weep and sigh because I'm blind, I cannot and I won't. Is that accepting your suffering as an 8-year-old child? Isn't that amazing? Her grandmother also taught her to memorize scriptures. She memorized 5 chapters a week. She could say, quote, the entire Pentateuch, the Gospels, Proverbs, and many Psalms. She used her suffering to know Him, that I may know Him and the fellowship of His sufferings. Her blindness gave her an incredible union with Jesus Christ. And so she was able, when she was 15, to go to a school for the blind in New York City. She was a poet, and she wrote for them, but she decided she wanted to use her talent in poetry to bring people to Jesus Christ. And so, as you know, she wrote hymns, and almost every Christian denomination sings these hymns. And some of them are, I Am Thine, O Lord, I've Heard Thy Voice, you know that one, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior, To God Be the Glory, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross, praise Him, Jesus Our Blessed Redeemer, Tell Me the Story of Jesus. I thought, isn't that? She was blind. Tell me the story of Jesus. Write on my heart every word. And she wrote a total of over 6,000 1,000 hymns. She wrote, at times, she wrote several a day. In fact, publishers had to use different names for some of her hymns. She had to write under a different name because there were too many Fanny Crosby hymns, and they were afraid people wouldn't like that. Our hymn book that we use has 16, I think, of her hymns in it. And she not only wrote hymns, but she also had a special heart for the poor. And she worked in rescue missions and served the poor. I thought that illustrated very well. Commit yourself to your faithful Creator and continue to do good. Not only did she write the hymns for us to sing for the Church of Jesus Christ, but she also served the poor. And she wrote her hymns, she said, for the poor. For those who might not be in church, that they could hear the gospel. And so at one time in her life, somebody said to her, Fanny, you have so many wonderful gifts. Just imagine what it would be like if you could see. And her answer to them was, do you know that if at birth I had been able to make one petition, it would have been that I was born blind. Because when I get to heaven, the face that shall ever gladden my sight will be that of my Savior. So when we suffer, let's suffer well, because the path to glory goes through suffering. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it speaks to us through the power of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, I pray that we will be a church that prays, that loves, that is hospitable, and that serves. And that we will gladly suffer for you, Lord, because we will see you one day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.